So here we are, part two of chapter two, project methodologies and processes. We've gone through this slide here, so we'll go ahead and continue on. So project phases, phase exits, stage gates, kill points. Remember what I said, here I go again, talking about, is today the day we stop the project? Is this the day we kill the project? Now, a lot of times we'll actually build those in so that they're reminders to ask that critical question. I've had projects that have failed. I've had projects that we've spent literally, 40 hours with five human assets to determine, this is not a project we're going to do now. We need to shelf it. We have something more important to do, or we don't have the budget or the resources to do it today. So we build in that idea of, is today the day we stop the project? Stop the bleeding, or, just literally make a good decision for the organization that it's not time. So, phase end review or key deliverables, again, staging through. Let's not forget also, as we create this project plan, to build in celebration, to build in those milestones when we reach the end of a certain portion to celebrate the work that we've done, to keep people engaged, to keep them excited. The longer a project is, the more important it is to keep people excited about the project. To get that word out. Literally, I've spent time marketing the project, delivering to the people that are going to be affected or going to be expected to use the system, what great work we're doing, when we're going to meet that, when they're going to see the product or the service, and how it's going to positively impact their work and their dedication to the company. Okay, so, allows the organization to evaluate project performance, take immediate action, correct errors or problems if they exist, asking those questions, are there problems? Fast tracking, starting the next phase of the project before approval is obtained for the current phase. Again, in waterfall, we wouldn't do that, but in agile, we're going to do that. We want to keep moving. Okay, but of course, there's inherent risk. It's risky. It should only be done when the risk is acceptable. So what happens if we start investing in phase two and phase one is not already done? In some cases, we can do that. In the fact that what I tend to do is look at phase one or look at the first step and say, okay, this is going well. We know it's going to complete. As we look at the risk of phase one, the risk seems to have been reduced or is non-existent. And thus we can actually start phase two knowing that phase one is indeed going to happen. Okay, so, generic projects, life cycle, here we are, again, define the project, plan the project, execute, choose the project, evaluate, audit, etc., close. I apologize, I'll have to change that. That should say close. So close the project. I'm going to just continue on. Project life cycle, define and plan. So define the project goal. Again, what is the goal? And this needs to be that high-end goal. It's not just that immediate goal to solve a problem, but is how does this play into the strategic goals of the company? So companies create strategic plans. Even a sole proprietorship, a one-person business, should create a plan, a strategic plan for 4 to 5 years of what they expect to accomplish. And we always want to look at projects and say, how does this help with the goal? Not just how does this help with the immediate need, or how does this solve the immediate project? So project goal, focused on, again, providing value to the business, to the organization, a clear focus, drives the other phases of the project, is successful if given time, money, and resources invested. Will it succeed? Planning the project, what are the objectives? What are the resources? What are the controls? So what controls are we going to put into place to know that this project continues on a successful path that still has an opportunity or probability to lead to success? And then again, controls like, is today the day we stop the project? In project meetings, that tended to be the first question I would ask in a meeting. What do you all think? How are we doing? What's going on? I want to communicate and make sure that my team agrees. So, you know, execute project plan, of course, how we do the work, when we're going to do the work, who is it going to affect? You know, progress must be documented compared to the baseline plan. So we have this plan, and what we want to do is start a subset of that document of, well, we said this would be done on Tuesday, but in fact, let's make a note that it was not done on Tuesday. It was done on Wednesday, and that put us one man day behind schedule. Why did that happen? Okay, it only takes a moment. We're not talking about writing a dissertation, just, you know, Bill was sick. It was Bill's job, so that put us a day behind. How is that going to exponentially perhaps affect the product or project, or how do we get the project back on its intended timeline? What happened? You know, in performance, communicated with all the stakeholders. Again, communication, communication, communication. In my classes, I start the week. If this is a project, right, you could think of the class as a project. We have goals that we need to meet called outcomes of things you need to learn. And how are we going to learn those? What are the steps we're going to take? What's working? What's not working for you as the customer? I use that term loosely because really I like to think of you as employees. The difference is you're paying me. But the value you get by the more work you do is the result, right? So, you know, close and evaluate the project. Again, final project report, presentation to the client, postmortem review, lessons learned, best practices. How was the budget? How did we perform? Who were the contributors? Who were the barriers, or what were the barriers? Who were the barriers to the project? You know, so in PMBOK, you know, 10 project management acknowledgement areas, we're going to look at these briefly. I'm not going to go through these in detail. Again, I would encourage you to pause, read this slide. You know, what does it mean to integrate and focus on coordinating the project plan development? Now, we're talking about a single project, but realize, as you learned in chapter one, we also need to look at this from a portfolio, a project portfolio. Are there other projects being done in other departments or within the organization that will help, if that makes sense? Okay, so scope provides assurance that the project's work is defined accurately. You'll hear the term along your education process of scope creep. This is where we make changes to the project that are going to somehow, whether it's time, money, resources, are going to affect the project. Now, they can affect it positively, but a lot of times scope creep is a huge negative. So we need to put in controls that manage scope creep, meaning a process that must be done. We're not going to just add a feature and functionality without looking at its impact on the programming that's been done, the programming that needs to be done, and the time that that's going to extend. That's where we end up with issues. That's why it's so important to plan, 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 and then realize there's a lot of things in the scope that we might say that's great, and boy, that would be a great feature, but we're going to leave that to a second phase project that impacts the project that we're doing. You know, time, of course, is important. Let's face it, we all only have 24 hours in a day. The great thing is with outsourcing now, we can be asleep while other people are working on projects for us. The internet makes that possible. Communication over the internet, Zoom, you know, the Zoom tool that I use for office hours is a great example. Cost, you know, the project remains within budget. It's developed completely. Quality, you know, focuses on the planning, the developing, the managing of the quality environment. Quality control can play into this. We can bring Deming's tools into project management, you know, procurement, you know, projects require resources, people. Let's not forget people. And when we talk about people, we need people at the high end of the company that are saying, this is an important project, even though if they're not involved at all, just having them in the meeting gives that interpretation that, wow, this is important to our CFO or our CEO or our quality, our vice president of quality or vice president of manufacturing, because he's the one that's supporting, or she's the one that is supporting the project. She's there, she's integrated. She's walking around asking people, that are involved in the project, not only the stakeholders, but people who are working on the project. How is it going? How are you feeling about it? Do you feel this is going to be good for our business? Again, human resources, procurement. The reason this is brought out from the rest is this is important. You know, I like to call human resources human assets, because when we talk about them as assets, we value assets more than just a resource, if you will. You know, so making sure that we have the right people to do the right work, that we are promoting them, that we are encouraging them, that we are taking barriers out of the way for them to be the contributor they want to be to the program. And also, you know, managing that human asset of, you know, we all have our stuff, you know, we all have lives outside of work. How is that affecting getting things done? You know, do we need to make changes? A lot of times the greatest challenge with human assets is they've been hired to do a job. You know, the quality manager is the quality manager, and she has to do her quality manager job. And that's what she was hired to do 40 hours a week. And then suddenly she just got put on this project team. And we've got to find time for her to have the time or create more resources to take workload off of her so that she can be there in the project and engaged in doing that work and not be thinking, geez, I'm sitting in an hour meeting when I should be doing X, Y, and Z. Communications are, of course, important. And today we have great communications. It's not just about the written email. You know, a lot of times the way I'm communicating with students now is through interactive videos, a one-on-one video about their assignment. Number one, it would take me a long time to email that. And people don't read emails. That's just the truth. If it's a long email, they're not going to read. The higher the educated person, the more they're going to skim for the pertinent information, use bullet points, make it quick, get in, get out. So a video like this allows me to say a lot in a very little time. Risk management, pretty clear on what that is. Stakeholder management, you know, identifying project stakeholders to be better understand their expectations, their interests. And then, of course, conflicts. So if we have a project that's being done for multiple departments or across an organization, where are we going to get, if you will, potential risks of trying to meet one stakeholder's requirements while missing out on the other? You know, and who are the stakeholders? And of course, you know, the higher up they are in the organization, the more influence they have on a project, okay? So that's definitely something to keep in mind as we go through this. So here's a quick, you know, just pause on this, look at this, you know, the project management process groups. We just talked about these. Understand, you know, conceptualize and initialize. So notice we go through this process here throughout these subsequent stages. Okay, so we can reiterate and go back through. We can plan, you know, we can initiate, we can plan, and then realize as we start executing, we should have spent more time planning. Stop the execution, go back to plan, do the execution, go into control, go into closing, you know, maybe having to come back and do other things. So I love this little slide, you know, and as we talk about management process groups, so initiating, planning, executing, here they are. Here's some ideas of what's going to be in that, you know, in conception and initiation, definition, planning, launch or execution, you know, performance control. Again, control, think of that also as management. So when we implement a project, it doesn't necessarily mean it's done. We might have bug fixes to fix. We might then get into a place where we do sub projects, or we agree to put some resources on improving what it is that we delivered. Okay. And then, of course, closing the project. Now, realize that we're always going to close the project. Once we deliver, we are going to close the project. The project needs to stop at some point. Then we might come back into a performance and control and maintenance project to enhance the deliverable that we already used. So monitoring, controlling, again, we talked about these, closing, very similar. So I think that's enough for this video. We should be able to finish the rest in the next. Take care.